Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Doug Owens. I direct the Center for Primary Care and Outcomes Research in the Department of Medicine and the Center for Health Policy and the Friedman Spogli Institute for International Studies. And on behalf of Stanford Health Policy, I want to welcome you. We have a tremendous program today, and I'm going to briefly introduce the speakers who really need no introduction, and then we'll get started on the topic, longevity, the benefits and burdens of an aging society. First, it's our absolute pleasure and privilege to introduce Lesley Stahl, who needs no introduction. Lesley is one of the most recognized and experienced broadcast journalists in the U.S. She's been a 60 Minutes correspondent since March 1991, and this is her 25th season. Really remarkable. Before that, she was the CBS News White House correspondent during the Carter and Reagan presidencies and part of the term of George H.W. Bush. She also has anchored a number of CBS News documentaries. She served as the moderator of Face the Nation from 1983 to 1991 and co-anchored America Tonight. Her career has been recognized, of course, with numerous awards, including a Lifetime Achievement Emmy Award in 2003, the Paul White Award for Lifetime Achievement, and the Edward R. Murrow Award. She also has a new book out, Becoming Grandma. She'll be signing books in the back, and you may have heard her yesterday on NPR talking about it. So anyway, get yours now while they last. All right, and Laura Carstensen. Laura is the founding director of the Stanford Center on Longevity. She's a professor of psychology. She's the Farley Dickinson Jr. Professor in Public Policy. She is one of the leading scholars on health and aging in the United States. She began the Center for Longevity. She's been recognized by the MacArthur Foundation Research Network on Aging Society. She's on the National Advisory Council for NIA. She's received numerous awards, including a Distinguished Mentorship Award for the Gerontologic Society, as well as a Guggenheim Fellowship. And she's really one of the leading scholars, and we are delighted that she's come with us, come here today to talk to us. And then, of course, Paul Costello, who you all know. Paul's the Chief Communications Officer at Stanford's School of Medicine. He's also a distinguished journalist. He came to us with an extensive background in journalism. He was the spokesman for First Lady Rosalynn Carter. He was the Ohio Governor Richard Celeste, Washington, D.C. Mayor Sharon Pratt, Kelly and Kitty Dukakis during the 1988 presidential campaign. And as you know, he is an outstanding interviewer. So with that, I want to turn it over to Paul. Thank you all so much for coming. We are absolutely delighted.
Thank you very much, Doug.
I want to interview him.
This is a real thrill to be interviewing Lesley Stahl. Lesley and I go back to 1977, I think we first met, when I was a White House staffer, and Lesley became a White House correspondent, so we go back a long time. We've been great friends. And then my wife and Lesley covered the Bush White House together. My wife's a journalist, and Lesley, and she and Lesley covered the Bush White House, so we have many roots. And Laura is a wonderful friend, and as Doug said, a great scholar who does amazing work here at the Center on Longevity. And thank you all for coming. I want to start with an iconic song. We all knew the words to this song. You'll recognize it as soon as, and I want to ask my two guests about this. The words were, when I get older, losing my hair. Those two have their hair. Many years from now, will you be sending me a Valentine, birthday greetings, bottle of wine? If I'd been out till 3:15, would you lock the door? Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64? So I want to start there. How many of you remember that song?
Oh my God.
I want to start there and ask, when you think back when you were a teenager and you heard that song, what did you think 64 would be like? And when you reached 64, what was it like?
Well, of course, we all thought 64 was the end. Yeah. Who lived past 64? And if you did, you were infirm, you had dementia, and your children were carrying you around the house.
Yeah.
And when I got into my 60s and felt like I was in my 40s, it was a huge, wonderful surprise. Mm-hmm. And now I'm in my 70s.
Which is amazing, 74.
No, but 64 is really young.
Very young.
Very young.
It's very young. Yeah. I mean, I think they could change the song now, the lyrics, and say, when I'm 104, and then maybe maybe it would have a little more resonance. I'm not 64, Paul. I'm only 62, so I don't know what it's like to be 64.
Right. You mentioned just now that the curve has changed dramatically. Yeah. And for the first time in this century, we're seeing people live into their hundreds. Yeah. And that the trend is going to be greater longevity. So the question really is, how are we going to live our lives? I remember right. interviewing somebody not long ago, a woman who was in her 90s, and she said, be careful what you wish for.
Yeah.
She said, come to my assisted facility and look around and be careful what you wish for. So the question is quality. So how do we, Laura, from what you've looked at, how do we ensure that we have that quality as we age?
Well, long lives are among the greatest gifts humans have ever received. Do you know what I mean? That a near doubling of life expectancy is, of course, a good thing. You know, it's death is the alternative. So this is good. But whether it's a good thing for societies, for families, for communities, really rests on the status of aging people. So to the extent that people arrive at old age, mentally sharp, physically fit, financially secure, then we're going to thrive. You know, aging societies will be the best thing that ever happened. Best thing that ever happened probably for world peace, certainly for children. You know, we regularly hearing about this tension and the pull and older people gobbling up all the resources. We need to make sure that older people are the resource. And then we change that whole kind of conversation. But it really depends on how we live our lives. And
which really leads to your book, Lesley, of the resource. And as you age, are you a resource? When did you think, obviously you are a grandmother of two, when did you think that there was something larger here than just your own story?
Well, as I got into the, I was asked to write the book. And I, at the beginning, said, no, I'm not going to do it. Realized eventually that there are so many different angles to cover on the subject of grandparents, and particularly grandmothers. So as I was researching and digging, I came around to your subject, which is, what are we all going to do when we have 30 more years after we retire?
Yeah.
And society's known that we are already there.
Yeah.
And yet, society hasn't done anything at all about planning for 30 years in retirement. We're not structured for it. Our politicians, heaven forbid, ever talk about it. I don't even know how you go about reordering something, the way people live out their lives, the way a society or a country is going to divide up our time. Mm-hmm. A public health official told me that she talks about life as 30, 30, 30. 30 years of education, 30 years of raising children and making money, and then 30 more years. What are we even calling those years? Well, I call them the grandparent years, but what are we going to do with them? And of course, I conclude we're going to take care of our grandchildren. And it's a wonderful thing. And it's good for everybody. It's good for the kids, believe me. We love those kids like nobody loves their children. It's good for us because it contributes to our health and our happiness.
Yeah.
And it's good for our children who are both working and not earning enough money, who cannot afford really good childcare. I mean, really good childcare can cost as much as college. And it's just a wonderfully productive way, gives people meaning. But society's not helping us, grandparents, spend the last 30 years of their life that way.
Laura, you've been looking at that reordering and in the Sightlines project and study that you did. And what you've really identified is that among a wide spread of demographics, we're in for some trouble, especially when you consider that people aren't really financially prepared.
Mm-hmm. Right. The Sightlines project is a project where we're attempting to help people see what the future looks like given the status of younger people today, younger adults, middle-aged adults, young old adults, and so on. We know a lot about what predicts long and healthy lives. And a lot of it is what Lesley just said. It's social engagement, it's meaning. Physical fitness has a lot to do with it, of course, and financial security does too. So what we're doing is tracking recent changes in six different age cohorts to see how people are faring early in their lives. And we, at the same time we released this report, had issued a survey through Peter Hart Associates and found that most Americans say they'd like to live to 100 if they could be in good health. And then you ask them, are you exercising? Are you eating right? Are you staying engaged? And the minority of the same people who say they'd like to live to be 100 are saying, no, I don't do any of that. And so we really do need to begin to think about the long haul. And we've never had to do that before. And we're not very good at it as humans.
Do you both?
Can I ask a biological question?
Sure.
It's a theory that as we live longer as a species, mm-hmm. that all the stages of life are stretching out.
Yeah.
And people say, you know, I have a kid, he's 35. He hasn't started his life yet.
Yeah.
He's the way I was when I was 25.
Mm-hmm.
But there's actually, is it true or is it just a theory?
Oh, it's true. I mean, there's evidence for it. People are delaying age at first marriage, age at first birth, so there is some of that. And I actually think instead of reordering stages, and let's get rid of stages, you know, and instead stretch out life. You know, I mean, you say we inherited a gift of 30 extra years for the average person from our ancestors just 100 years ago. And what we've done is to tacitly put all of them at the end and say, what are we going to do with these years? As opposed to saying, where would you put them? Well, you know, I ask people all the time, where would you put them? A lot of people would put them during those years when they're raising young children. Stretch that out. Stretch out the middle years. Stretch out adolescence.
I'll make it less than 30 is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Tandem with longevity, with increasing age, with longevity of life, is the discrimination. I mean, there still seems to be significant discrimination, ageism in this country, you know, and everywhere in jobs across the border. Is that is the stigma of aging changing?
Yes. I'll tell you why. And that's part of this book too. I'm going to mention the book about 1,000 times. Get used to it.
Leslie's written a book.
And it's really good.
I brought my friend with me. What was I going to say? About 1,000. I forget where I was going to say, but it was good. I'll come back to it.
Ageism. Ageism is getting better.
Ageism, right. It's all about the baby boomers. Mm-hmm. Baby boomers are 50 to 70. We have been a huge force as we've swept through life. We have changed everything wherever we go. We change the culture. We change music. We change clothes. We want to stay young. We're not perming our hair and letting it go white. We're all blondes, most of us. I see one that isn't, but most of us are blondes.
I wish.
We work. We work. We still work, you know, deep into. So when boomers en masse get older with their sensibility about staying young, it's going to change. I think it's already changing the stigma. And when I started to write the book, a man, you know, I won't name him because it's embarrassing, said to me, you can't write about being a grandmother. You're going to tell everybody that you're a grandmother? It's crazy. It's career suicide. And I knew that there are more grandmothers in the country today than there have ever been just because of the baby boomers.
Yeah.
We're all becoming grandmothers. Well, we already know. The whole room is grandmothers. And we're going to change attitudes.
What's interesting when we talk about attitudes and ageism is that in this presidential campaign, there are three people who are older than 65. Yeah. Donald Trump.
Grandfather.
Sanders.
Grandfather.
And Hillary Clinton.
Grandmother.
And you know, in 1980, when Ronald Reagan ran, mm-hmm. all of the questions were about, is this man mentally equipped to run for president because of his age? You've not heard that discussion at all this
at
time
all.
Around.
There's
Isn't that not amazing? Been one. Why is that?
Well, you know, as recently as when McCain was running, I got lots of calls from people saying, isn't he too old to be a president?
But not this time.
Not this time. I haven't gotten
Baby
a single
boomers.
Query about it.
I'm telling you, yeah. we've already changed
yeah.
the attitudes of people in their late 60s and early 70s.
But why is it a changing in the workplace? Why is there still widespread discrimination in ages?
But it's less.
You think so?
I know it's less. Look, I'm still around. Can you believe it?
Laura, you've done some work on knowing that mm-hmm. that when you bring mm-hmm. elderly people into the workforce, that they really broaden the dimensions yeah. of the workplace and intellectualism. Talk more about that research.
Yeah, I think we're just beginning to see what mixed age workforces do, and it looks really good.
That's good.
But I think ageism remains a big, big problem. And people like you, Lesley, are changing things, and it's tremendous. But an awful lot of companies and employers say that they're trying to find ways to develop ways that they can have graceful exits to get rid of older workers. There are two things that concern them. One is salaries. They cost more, and healthcare costs are more. That's a real problem. It's got practical solutions to it. But the other is that I think there's still widespread beliefs that older people are slow, a little dull, a little less productive. And those are simply myths. When we actually begin to look and measure productivity, it varies by job. But if you work in a knowledge-based job, productivity goes up with age. If you work in a job that's knowledge-based and has a social component too, then it skyrockets up with age.
And why is that?
Because it matters. Your relationships matter with people, and the knowledge that you've acquired over time matters. And so even if we're a little bit slower, if our memories aren't quite as good, if you know 10 times more than you did 20 years earlier, you still do the job quite well. As I say, in some jobs, it's not the case. Those kinds of jobs where it's simply basically a reaction time test. Say you do a computer-based job and you just push a button every time something appears on your screen, people get slower. That's this fundamental kind of slowing. But that's not the typical job in this country. And so in other kinds of jobs, we're just beginning to see the real strengths of older workers. And when you put them together with younger workers, that's when you really see sparks fly. It looks really good.
The other thing that you have done some research on is the brain and how, obviously, as we age, we lose capacity in the brain, memory and other things. Mm-hmm. But you've also studied that we gain something. What do we gain? Mm-hmm. What are the gains? Everyone want to know what the gains are?
We're better at solving practical problems of life, what people call wisdom. So we and again, it's knowledge that we're putting together with challenges and solving them. There's increasingly the feeling that you've been here before when you confront a difficult situation, and you can think and reason about different ways you might solve it. And the other surprising strength that we've revealed that occurs with age is that emotional well-being improves and emotional regulation improves. Again, think of this as a societal resource. People who are really good at solving practical problems of life, and they're emotionally even-handed and can solve hotly charged emotional conflicts better than younger people, what is a world that's got that resource growing going to look like? If we just keep going and don't recognize the value of this, we will pass up probably the greatest potential to change the world than we've ever faced in human
So
history.
How do we not keep on going and pass it up? What's sort of the plan on how not to do that?
Well, can we just for 1 second?
Yeah.
I think we're in the very eye of a huge change, and I think the political question is part of this, mm-hmm. that we have the three top candidates who are past 65, well past 65, is proving it. Mm-hmm. We're accepting that age group as competent, mm-hmm. not slow, people mm-hmm. we'd be willing to follow.
And can take the 3 o'clock in the morning phone call.
And still yeah. can take the three, yeah, all of that. And maybe yeah. show the wisdom of not panicking.
Yep.
So I think we're in the throes of it. So go ahead.
I think that's right, exactly right. I think the way you've said it, that we're in the eye of it,
yeah,
is why we don't see what's happening so well. So we still sit here and talk about all the problems of older people and this and that, but I think we'll hit a tipping point real soon. I think we're seeing it already. You know, 5 years ago, if you looked at the mainstream media, most of the headlines about older people were, you know, declining productivity, we're going to break Medicare, Social Security, and I think there's been a shift recently, and will continue to be a shift where we're talking about the advantages of having a lot of grandmothers in the world.
And in terms of the economic piece of it, what I found is that more and more 65-year-olds, being boomers and believing that they're 35, are not retiring at 65 for a lot of reasons. One is they feel young and they like what they do and on the jobs. They need the money, all the reasons.
Yeah.
So people are delaying taking their Social Security checks. And that's going to alleviate some of the stress on Social Security. Here's something else I found that I just blew my mind. The baby boomers have more money than any of the other generations. And this has never happened before in our history, that generation, 60, 70-year-olds, and even 80-year-olds, mm-hmm, have more money than 30, 40, 50-year-olds. This is all brand new. So we are supporting our grandchildren, mm-hmm, to a huge degree never really seen before, mm-hmm, where grandparents are spending, this is one of my favorite all-time statistics that I came upon. Mm-hmm. Grandparents today are spending 7 times more on their grandchildren than grandparents did just 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. 7 times more today.
One of the things that was really interesting also in the book is that you talk to a lot of grandparents who had grandparenting and parenting thrust on them. The children their children,
yeah.
abandoned, you know, and basically they weren't happy campers. They now were thrust with 24/7 being parents. What did they tell you? And what's out there to help them?
There's almost nothing out there to help them. Take a grandmother or grandfather if they're, you know, she's not a widow, which is pretty common. And one day her child either goes to jail, is an addict and can't take care of the child, or dies. And the child is either abandoned to the foster care system, which is, you wouldn't do that to anybody you know and liked, or you take them in. No services, no help, no programs, and there they are, maybe they're 70 years old, and not only do they have a kid to take care of, they've got a child who either lost his or her parent or was rejected. So they have a troubled child. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing in society that helps those grandparents. My sister-in-law is a psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. A lot of her patients or clients are in that situation. And she calls them the unsung heroes because they're raising kids who would otherwise, mm-hmm, their lives would be basically over. And they're saving those lives, but they are under enormous stress. And their dreams of how they were going to spend the last 30, 20, whatever, of their lives are just shattered. Mm-hmm. But they're wonderful. They're raising babies.
How do men, and how does the brain age differently, or does it age differently? You looked at grandmothers and grandfathers. You know the brain. And how does it age differently in men and women? Is there a significant difference?
That's an interesting question. That most of the work on neural changes with age show similar kinds of effects for women and for men. If we look at emotional changes, men become a little bit more like women. They're a little bit more emotionally attuned and a kind of kinder, gentler sort of profile emerges in older people. You see the same for women, but for women it's been relatively more constant.
Lesley has two great stories about two people, Aaron Latham, her husband, who has Parkinson's, and Bob Simon. And tell those stories, because they're really great stories about...
Okay, but let me say, since they're both men, grandfathers go through a giant transformation. Grandmothers do too. And it's I did a lot of work, because the book is the science of grandparenting as well as just being madly in love with your own grandchildren. But we go through enormous physiological changes. And grandfathers are unrecognizable. There they are, at least my husband and a lot of others, having tea parties with their granddaughters and playing dolls, playing dollhouse with their grandchildren. I mean, it's just a stunning thing to behold if you're just watching grandpa. Mm-hmm. So my husband, what I found was that grandparenting is therapeutic. And it's been documented. It's not just anecdotal. It's actual. So my husband has Parkinson's. And our first granddaughter was born. And he was in the throes of it. He'd probably had it for about 6 years by then. All the symptoms went away. Stunning. What the heck happened here? Maybe he didn't have Parkinson's. We went from specialist to specialist, because you don't get better with Parkinson's. It's kind of... So one doctor told us that he had probably had West Nile virus. Please. I mean, that even was ridiculous. Another doctor, and this was my favorite theory, said that there's such a thing as disease vacation, where your disease just goes off and swims around and sits in the sun for a while. Of course, the Parkinson's roared back.
Yeah.
You know. But it did have that kind of a dramatic effect. And of course, Dr. Stahl here diagnosed it as grandfather vacation or whatever. But the other more documented effect is if a man particularly is in the throes of depression and he takes care of a grandchild, it's been shown that the depression lifts. And it happened to Bob Simon.
Simon, as you know, 60 Minutes, mm-hmm. passed away.
Was in a killed in a horrible car accident, terrible, terrible. But he was in a deep depression, and his grandson Jack was born, and poof, I'm telling you, he popped out of it. Mm-hmm. Just the depression after a long time just went away.
What did you find when you Lesley, of course, took this book on as you would imagine, as an investigative reporter. So she didn't just write these, you know, stories about what it was like to play with your kids. She went in and dug in and met with researchers, met with neurologists, and went across the board.
Made it fun.
What surprised you the most in this investigative journey?
Two things. The first was painful. That there are large numbers of grandparents who are not allowed to see their grandchildren. They either are not allowed to see them or they're rationed. Once I found out that this was out there, I fell upon it time and again. It's a horrible secret. It's shameful to the grandparents. They don't want to tell anybody because they think people will say, oh my God, what did they do to deserve such a punishment? But there's a lot of that out there. And I come around in the book and I say, if you've had a strained relationship with your kids and you're desperate to see your grandchildren, my answer is grovel. Do whatever you have to do to get back in their good graces.
What are the main reasons why they won't let them see their grandchildren?
Well, they're still angry at us for how we parented, or we said something, or we did something, and they're I actually interviewed a lot of those parents, and they said, I'm not going to let them do to my kids what they did to me. Of course, me turned out just fine as far as I could tell. It's silly, it's childish, it's emotional, and really the ones they're hurting are their own children. These children need their grandparents. And the truth is that none of us grandparent the way we parented. It is night and day, and it's brought on by this huge physiological change within us. If we were strict, if we were tough on our kids, if we picked them apart, as my mother did, we are mushballs with those grandchildren. We don't even recognize ourselves. We're giving them candy. We're letting them watch, you know, we're letting them play on the iPad. Mm-hmm. Our children have said to us, no candy, don't you dare give them candy, and we're slipping. We can't say no. It's like we've had no surgically removed. I don't know, the word won't come out of our mouths. We grandparent in the most permissive, indulgent way, no matter what kind of a parent we were. We have to get that message out to our kids. If you know, you're still resentful over something I said to you.
Go to a therapist.
Go to a therapist. Get over it. And I'll be different. I won't even be able to help myself.
Yeah. You know, Laura, you mentioned a few minutes ago social engagement. And social engagement is really down among baby boomers. Yeah. What do you see there? What are the problems there? First of all, define social engagement. Mm-hmm. What are the problems? And what are the implications?
Mm-hmm. So by social engagement, in the Sightlines report, we're talking about having meaningful relationships with other people, having a partner that you can count on, having friends that you can count on, but also engagement in community organizations, religious organizations, so in the larger community. And we've looked at this again in six different age cohorts from 20 to 35 and 35 to 45 and so on up. And we're seeing less social engagement pretty much across the board than we did 20 years ago. But it's particularly pronounced in the baby boomers. And when you were talking about the baby boomers, sort of changing the tide, I think it will happen. When I looked at the findings from Sightlines, I got really concerned about how it's going to happen.
Is that this? Is this the reason why social engagement?
So, that's possibly why these traditional measures of social engagement look pretty bad, but people may be compensating by using virtual interactions. So if we just look at, we're mining longitudinal data sets that have been around a long time and looking at how people have changed over history on these measures, but nobody's got measures that are, how often do you Skype with your grandchildren? How often do you talk to your parents, and using some electronic form? And that we just don't have those data. So it may be that people are doing better than it looks. But it also may be that the boomers, being a boomer, I can talk about them both positively and negatively too. Yeah. But we rebelled against a lot of traditional relationship norms. Weren't going to get married, weren't going to have kids, and eventually we did all these things. But we did fight against them a lot. And it could be that some of that's coming back to bite us now, and that we need to change.
What are the implications?
We were, as a species, going back to the caveman, organized in a family situation where the grandmothers took care of the children. The cavemen went out and hunted, but so did the cave women. Mm-hmm. They both hunted, and they both raised the crops when we got around to that. So in all of human history, grandparents have been an integral part of the family. We have not been separated from the family. We've all lived together, and the grandmother took care of the child. And then we got to the 20th century. Hmm. And it isn't only the baby boomers, it's what happened to our mobile society. Yeah. We cut that cord, and you're telling us it's not healthy.
It's not healthy.
It's not healthy. Mm-hmm. And I see a huge trend of grandparents moving back to mm-hmm. be with their grandchildren and children. Once they retire, I bet you all know people who have done this. They retire, they give up their houses that they've lived in for 50 years, their friends, and they move because they're yearning and craving mm-hmm. those babies, and the babies need us, and we're being drawn back to this old society.
It's a beautiful match. And there are anthropologists who argue that we live as long as we do as a species because of grandmothers.
Yes.
And it's the effect it's called the grandmother hypothesis. And it appears, if you look at this, Kristen Hawkes is responsible for this idea. She's an anthropologist at University of Utah. And she observes hunting and gathering societies in modern times. So she's got observational data on this. What happens is you see a mother out, and she measures how much they collect in food, nuts and berries, so how much is collected. The mother has a child. The mother continues to collect. The second child arrives. And what you see is this peak in the grandmothers hunting and gathering. And so the grandmother's now taking care of the older child. It's the older child, the eldest, that's at risk when the second baby is born, because the mother's nursing the baby and she doesn't have as much time to gather. But the presence of a grandmother predicts the odds of that child surviving. And so there are people who think, you know, for a long time we've had an evolutionary theory, past menopause, what's the use of you? You know, that's, you know, you may as well die because there's no more.
Well, all other animals, we do. We're the only animals.
Although there are a couple, vervet monkeys, lions, also live longer past the reproductive age. And it turns out the grandparental lions are taking care of cubs. So in the species where we see that,
I wish I'd known that. I know about elephants and whales and humans. But yeah. I didn't look at grandfathers.
Oh, that's fabulous. So here's the thing about
paperback.
Grandfathers, though. Grandfathers. So Kristen Hawkes was criticized for calling it the grandmother hypothesis. And I thought also when I thought, why didn't she call it the grandparent hypothesis and said grandmother hypothesis?
She didn't
look at her
males like me.
Well, she did, actually.
Oh, she did.
And she says, yeah, you know, they gather more at all ages than women. But the problem is they don't share. And it's the grandmothers who are, you see this peak in hunting and gathering, and they're giving it to the little ones.
What are the implications of a society that bowls alone? The famous book, yeah. Bowling Alone.
Yeah.
What are the implications and ramifications of that, Laura? What and our policymakers and people who really should be thinking about these long-term impacts, are they thinking about the implications of longevity?
I think they're not thinking about it at all. Social isolation, the perceived sense, the subjective feeling that you're alone in this world, that you don't have anybody you can count on, is great of a risk factor for mortality as cigarette smoking. It's a big effect.
It's cigarette smoking.
Yeah.
Significant.
We are not as humans. Again, think about it for a minute. We can't survive as humans without other people. From a baby being born can't make it on its own. You know, people have to be there for you and really be there for you. And so we're hardwired to need other people. Throughout life, that doesn't change, and you can see physical effects on people, hypertension. You see all sorts of changes in cortisol levels, and when people feel alone, when they feel lonely. So it's really important for the individual to be engaged. For all the reasons we're talking about, it's important now for societies, for older people to be engaged in communities, in families, in neighborhoods.
Lesley, you talked about in the book two really interesting programs, projects. One, you did a report for 60 Minutes, and that was a program in the Bronx. And the other is a program that you found out about in Rantoul, Illinois, at a former Air Force base. And both of them are really very original ideas, and one would want to replicate them around the country.
I don't know if I can.
Water.
I've been having these coffee. No, I'm drinking the
Here.
Tea.
There's one.
You talk, and I'll come back to that.
Okay.
Because I'm sorry.
Water.
Laura, the Sightlines that you did really looked at across the board issues and problems and where the significant issues are. What did you find when you looked at young, you know, people first starting out in life and trying to, what are the issues there? And when you try to spread that, I'm thinking again of the implications of this. It was a broad study that looked at all demographics across the board.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we looked in these three domains, and we've organized the Center on Longevity, by the way, around these three domains, mobility, mind, and financial security. And again, we're seeing these as three legs of a stool. If you're physically fit, mentally sharp, and socially engaged, if you're financially secure, if those three legs are there, life is good. And societies thrive when their citizens are doing well. When we looked at variables in those three domains in Sightlines, and what we find is that you see different sorts of problems for different age groups. And among the youngest Americans, what we're seeing is what Leslie's already mentioned. It's the financial insecurity. Young people today are graduating with five times the level of college debt that they had 20 years ago. We're seeing in the last 14 years an increase by 20% in the level of debt in this 25 to 34-year-old age group. So, and what we also see is they're not getting married, and they're not buying houses, and they're not investing in retirement savings accounts the way that their counterparts did just 14 years ago. And so we're seeing these trends that are really alarming in young Americans today.
And you saw that trend also, the financial trend continued throughout all demographics, right? All age groups.
Yeah. All age groups except for those who are over 65.
Right.
And again, Leslie touched on this already too. In part, that's because people in that age group are living on pensions and Social Security income, so it's more stable. So we see less of a change in that age group. Compared to younger people. Where you really see the greatest concern is in the youngest, and it lessens as people get older.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I want to tell everyone, do I have a voice at all? This has been going on all day with me, with my voice. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So there's this community. It'll come back as I talk. There's this community that was started by a woman who was writing her PhD thesis on the foster care system. She was so appalled at how kids were being shunted from one family to the next, rejected, that she created one of these utopian communities. She got 12 houses. She asked the Pentagon if she could have 12 houses on a military base. They gave her 80 houses.
Oh.
Take it or leave it. You had to take the whole compound. They wouldn't give her 12. She got 12 families to adopt families of foster kids. And a lot of them were single women, but there were several husbands and wives, some with their own children. And they would take in four or five troubled kids and adopt them. No foster care. They had to adopt them. They got beautiful houses, gorgeous houses, for free. They got a stipend. And their job was to raise these kids.
The stipend was from the local government, the state?
Partly from foster care. Mm-hmm. So she was hooked into the state of Illinois
social
agency, whatever it's called. But also she raised funds. And the idea was that these families would live together in a big community. And if the kids got too much, and you did want to reject them, because they were all troubled, the community would circle around you and be like a posse. And you would continue with the kids, because everybody else was in the same boat. But she had 72 houses empty. You don't want to have a beautiful community with empty houses. So she put notices in magazines like AARP and so forth, and also airline magazines, inviting senior citizens, retirees, to come and live in subsidized houses on this military base. She wasn't thinking that they would be an integral part of this incredible community. They were just going to come and live there. So retirees came, and a lot of them had been bored to death. They were sitting home watching television and being miserable. A lot of them came with serious health problems, depression, heart disease, organically, just because it happened. The seniors started becoming the grandparents. The kids started calling them grandpa and grandma. Mm-hmm. And the kids, you had to let the kids choose who their grandmother was. You couldn't lean in because those kids would reject you. Mm-hmm. Because their definition of adult is someone who smacks them around a lot. So over time, every one of the kids had a grandmother and had a grandfather that they chose. And this is a community now that's been there for 20 years. It is amazingly successful in nurturing these troubled children. Oh, and the seniors also help the parents, who at times are just at their wit's end with these children. Mm-hmm. One, in one case, these two senior men keyed on this one child who was violent, difficult. He'd already been kicked out of one school. Now he's in another school. He's about to be kicked out of that school because he was disrupting the class, beating up the other kids. So these two grandfathers went to school with him every day. Then they traded off. One day George went, the next day Henry went. And they just sat next to him. Just sat there, just to calm him down. And if he started to act up, they just put their hand on his shoulder. And they they made this, I know, they taught the kid how to self-control. It was breathtaking. This model is being replicated.
Where else is it?
They've got one in Portland, Oregon. The one in Illinois is called Hope Meadows. A lot of them have the word hope in them. There's one in Amherst, Massachusetts, Washington, D.C., New Orleans. So it's being, there, other communities are coming in and looking at this model, and it really works. I'll be brief on the other one. The other one is the grandparent building in the Bronx, where grandmothers who get custody live in the most beautiful apartment building, but there are only 50 units. The city built it, and they give these grandparents amazing services, lessons in how to deal with disruptive teenagers. They tutor the kids. This should really be replicated all over the country, this model, because there are grandparents everywhere who are raising children in isolated situations.
We're going to close this portion of and open it to questions from the audience, but I want to close with one question for both of you. The last chapter of your book, Lesley, is entitled A Call to Arms, A Call to Arms, which is interesting for a journalist to be in that position. When I read that chapter, I was like, wow, that's interesting. For a journalist doesn't like to be an advocate, a call to arms, but you did. And so I want to ask each of you, what is the call to arms out there right now as we look at the issues that are facing this nation as it concerns longevity and aging?
Well, I wrote that because it was in me and it had to come out. It just needed to come out of me, and I've already alluded to it. The call to arms, grandparents, if you're involved with your grandchildren, get more involved. If you're not involved, do become that way. And if you're having trouble with your own children because they don't want you around, find a way to make up with them. As I said before, grovel if you have to, because your grandchildren need you. You have a job. You're the ones who give them unconditional love, and everybody needs that in their lives. The other call to arms is to the parents. Forgive your parents, get over it, grow up, and let them help you. And that's my call to arms. And I think that it will help with the isolation that older people feel. And this business that they're not connected and having friendships and so forth. If you're taking care of your grandchildren, you're going to be friends with the other grandmothers who are taking care of them. It'll just be wonderful for everybody all the way around and society. And so that's my call to arms.
Laura, what do you
I'd have a very similar kind of a thought. I think the message we've given older adults in this country for decades now is to step away and make room for younger people to come and take over. It's to be passive, to get out of the limelight. And I think we need to start to envision older people as being the cavalry coming over the hill. It is a call to arms. Very much so. There's a lot of need in this world, and the kinds of problems that we're facing, and especially young people are facing, are the types of problems that emotionally stable, wise people can fix. Having somebody in the world who's crazy about you, which is what a lot of grandparents do, is the essential ingredient for a kid to thrive. We're reaching a point in human history where we're going to have more old people than children, and that should be the very best thing that ever happened to children. But we've got to get engaged.
And yes, we should be engaged with our grandchildren. And I would say to those of you out there who don't have a grandchild, you're sitting around kind of waiting for the grandchild to come, go get one.
Surrogate.
Find one, because there's a lot of kids out there who don't have anybody looking after them in that way. And that's the call to arms, I think.
We never even talked about this.
No.
It's the same call to arms.
It's the same call to arms.
Please thank Lesley Stahl and Laura Carstensen.
Thank you.
It's so fun.
Yeah. Thank you.
There are two microphones, and back here. Do you want to step up? The mics are up here, so you're going to have to step up. Thank you.
Thanks so much for coming and talking with us today. I have a question. It's a little bit different than what you're talking about, but on the other end of the aging process for people and how it's integrated into families, sometimes people are shut away, and so people haven't experienced or know what it looks like to see grandparents die. And so they might be frightened of it. And so how would you integrate that into the coming experiences and years?
I can remember my own grandparents being close to us, dying, and I think that it's a part of life. Mm-hmm. We're sanitizing things too much. Mm-hmm. Children have to know that there's a cycle. They always did.
They always did, yeah. Throughout most of history, death has been premature. 100 years ago, people didn't even associate death with old people. You associated death more strongly with babies because they were the ones at greatest risk. And people died at all ages, got the flu, got a gastrointestinal bug, and died. And so death was very common, and most families experienced it, and it was in the home. I agree with Lesley. I think we're sort of afraid of that part of life, and it's a very natural part of life. And we're experiencing less of it these days, which is why I think it seems even more frightening, because it doesn't happen as much, and it doesn't happen in the home.
I also think there's a lesson to children when they see their parents taking care of their sick or aging parents. There's a lesson in caring for your family we've gotten away from.
A couple things. I'm old enough, being a trailing member of the baby boom generation, to remember about 25, 30 years ago when they started talking about essentially co-housing a daycare center with the nursing home population. And I think that concept has moved forward, but listening to everybody talk, my contention would be that we have a lot further to go, yeah? That's kind of a concern. But it's getting better. It's better than it was 30 years
There's
ago.
There's more of it.
There's more of it.
It moves slowly, though. Sadly. I did a story on Jane Fonda. Now, that when she wrote her book, it's at least 10 years ago. Yeah. Jane Fonda had a program in Atlanta that she started when she was married to Ted Turner. So that's how many years ago that was. And she set up a program in the Atlanta schools where elderly women could come and take care of the children of the teenage girls in school, and just hold them and rock them while the kids went to school. So this idea of senior citizens in the community coming in to help with kids has been around, but very slow going. There's no public policy, is what we said at the beginning. Good. And there really does need to be all the way around.
Okay, good. I'm glad to hear that. The second point I want to make was, I just finished reading the book by the brilliant young whippersnapper Atul Gawande, who quotes you in Being Mortal extensively, quotes your research, which shocked me not at all, but I expected
Thank
to
you.
See that. But the thing that he said that really struck me has to do with autonomy versus safety and self-determination amongst older populations, meaning that kids, that nursing home administrators, for example, market safety and custody to the kids putting their parents in a home, whereas that's completely antithetical to the actual interests and life cycle of the people who are getting thus imprisoned. And I just want to hear some more comments about that. I mean, that's the that's a quick and dirty sketch of that issue, but that he talks about that in at great length and in great detail. And I was wondering, since he quoted you, would you quote him or somebody else?
That's a wonderful book, Being Mortal.
Yes.
You know, I think an awful lot of our focus on older adults as younger adults is that we want to take care of. And most of the research on social relationships and aging focuses on social support of the elderly. How can we make sure they're not lonely? How can we take care of them? And you notice I'm using they and them, not we. And what much better predictor of well-being is whether they feel like someone else needs them, not whether somebody's there for them to protect them. And I think when that starts to sink in, we will, again, see more roles for older adults where we begin to make the ask and say, we need you for this. Mm-hmm. Imagine the day you wake up in the morning and you say, you know, there's not a soul on this planet who needs me to do anything. That is not a good day. So that's what, I think that's the change, the shift we need to make. Thank you.
Since people are inclined to answer the questions that an interviewer gives with what they expect the interviewer to want, and how can journalists find out what the decision makers are really planning and thinking without becoming their friends and bonding with them?
That's to you, Lesley.
Well, you know, my mind is going here. I'm not sure it's the answer you're looking for, but public policy has to start in a room like this. It has to bubble up. And citizens have to start demanding that kind of change and forcing the discussion into the public square. And there is this need now to talk about this, to talk about the last 30 years, or if we can make it 20 years, whatever, and just make it bubble up. Force it into a situation where there is policy, where there are more programs where senior citizens can help babies and other kids, little kids who need their help. It's not going to grow out of some politician's head. Excuse me. I'm about to have a second coughing fit. I'm going to get up and walk to the end of the room, do my cough, and come back. All right.
And we are done. Thank you very much for joining us.
The preceding program is copyrighted by the Board of Trustees of the Leland Stanford Junior University. Please visit us at med.stanford.edu.